Well, I'm very happy to be at this conference, even though I'm virtually there celebrating Thomas' birthday. Thomas inspired the whole generation, or current generation, I guess, of geometric group theorists in France, both by his work. I mean, there were a lot of things that we were trying to understand, and Thomas's exposition was brilliant and gave us a really new insight. And he was also very generous, sharing his ideas with many people. And finally, he has a great passion of mathematics that was contagious, I think. So it was really great to talk to him. And in fact, one of the topics somehow goes back to a lunch I had with Thomas 30 years ago. Maybe I will go back to this later. But let me start. So this talk is kind of two talks, but I would like to show you an instance where ideas that we use in coarse geometry apply also in differential geometry, or in systolic geometry anyway. So let me start with this. So there will be two halves in this talk, both dealing with some kind of dimension. The first half is about asymptotic dimension that I think is now familiar to people that are doing geometric group theory. So we know it's a large scale analog of topological dimension. Now, the other type of dimension I'll talk about is macroscopic dimension, or more specifically, n-Uryson width, which you have a space, say a manifold, and you see how close it is to something lower dimensional, to a lower dimensional simplicial complex. So I will go back, of course, and give definitions of this, but this is what this will be about. And I'll try to convince you that, in fact, we can use similar arguments for both types of dimensions. So let me start with asymptotic dimension. I just recall the definition. So the asymptotic dimension is less than n if for every m there is some constant d of m, and the covering by sets of diameter at most d of m says that every m ball in x intersects at most n plus one elements of the cover. So just to illustrate, let's prove that the asymptotic dimension of the Euclidean plane is at most 2. You might have seen this proof. You just have this covered by bricks, by big bricks, say. If you take a ball, an M ball, you take a brick of size 10M by 10M by 20M or something. And now you see that this M ball is going to intersect at most 3 of your bricks, which shows that the asymptotic dimension is at most 2, and it's easy to see it's not 1. And again, you have to play this game to draw this picture for every m, right? But it's always the same picture. Another example is trees. Trees have asymptotic dimension 1 if they are unbounded. Now, the main reason we care about this is that if G is a finitely generated group of finite asymptotic dimension, then the Novikov conjecture holds for G, a result of U. So generally, we try to prove, so this is a way to prove the Novikov conjecture for a group. It's easy to see that this is a quasi-symmetry invariant, the asymptotic dimension, and one can take a finer notion. So if we can take D of M to be linear, so D of M, remember, was just a constant depending on M. So if we can take it to be linear, then we have the stronger notion that the Schwarz-Nagada dimension of X is at most N. So now I will be interested. So again, as I said, generally, we want to know if this is finite. But in this talk, I will be interested in asymptotic dimension in itself. So I see it as a geometric invariant, and I want to calculate it, right? So, and there are some results in this spirit. So the most important perhaps is this result by Bialo-Lebedeva. So if G is a hyperbolic group, Then we can give an exact formula for the asymptotic dimension. The asymptotic dimension is equal to the topological dimension of the boundary plus one. So for hyperbolic groups, we can calculate the asymptotic dimension. And then there are some results by Gromov and Lang, Slich and Meyer about Hadamard manifolds. So Hadamard manifolds of dimension n and pinched curvature have asymptotic dimension exactly equal to n. But if we make pinched from this, I don't think we know that the asymptotic dimension is even finite, right? So we need pinched curvature to say something, to calculate. Now, another result, planes have asymptotic dimension less or equal to 2. So when I say planes, one can take planar graphs or planes with some Riemannian metric. And now, this might appear trivial. Of course, we just said that R2 has dimension 2. However, here we allow any metric. And now if you try to do this with R3 and you put any metric in R3, you can easily construct a metric with infinite asymptotic dimension, right? So in dimension 3 and above. So the way to do it, for example, take R3 and invent expanders, sequence of expanders, there just by tweaking the metric. So this is, so in this case, we can give a more or less exact formula. And this is the result together with Fujiwara. We gave the bound 3, and then Jorgensen, Lang, and this bunch of people, Bonami, Busquets, Perret, Groenland, Liu, Pirot, and Scott, remarked that, in fact, one can push our proof, because what we are proving is we are proving actually that the Assad-Nagata dimension of spheres is at most 1 there, which suffices using some earlier results to prove that to give the bound of 2. So you can also remark that a plane can have asymptotic dimension 1. For example, think of a cylinder, right? A half cylinder and cap off a half cylinder. This is a plane. Again, it's homeomorphic to a plane. It has a strange metric and it has asymptotic dimension 1. But if you have a one-ended plane, the asymptotic dimension is exactly 2. And now some further results of exact calculation. If we take one relator groups, then they have asymptotic dimension 2. This is a recent result by Telekidis. And now the same bunch of people showed that minor restricted families of graphs have asymptotic dimension 2. So this, so a minor restricted family of graphs is you take a family of graphs that is not allowed to contain some other graph as a minor. This is an important class of graphs for graph theorists and computer scientists. So that generalizes planar graphs, and it turns out that the result from planes can be generalized in this family. I mean, it's a different proof to show that these graphs have asymptotic dimension 2. A couple of comments. First of all, as I said, this is an important theory, the theory of minor restricted graphs. It is developed by Seymour Thomas, and it has a very geometric flavor, but it is unknown to geometers outside graph theory, which I think is a pity, because it's a really geometric theory that should be widely understood. So another peripheral remark is that it turns out that computer scientists also have studied asymptotic dimension. This is something I didn't know. So they have some results because they are also interested in the composition of spaces. So maybe that's why some of these names are not familiar when we talk about asymptotic dimension, is that it turns out that asymptotic dimension is interesting beyond geometric group theory. So finally, another example, Hadamard manifolds of dimension 3 have asymptotic dimension equal to 3. So this uses the previous result on planes, and it's done by Jorgensen and Lang. As I said, in general, for Hadamard dimension n we don't even know the asymptotic dimension is finite, but for three, we have this result without restrictions. Okay, so I would like to talk of another natural class of spaces, which are graphs of polynomial growth. So Spakula and Tikuisis in 2018 asked the question if graphs of polynomial growth have finite asymptotic dimension. So of course, one might be interested in this from a geometric perspective. A main example of spaces of polynomial growth are manifolds of non-negative Ricci curvature. So one could ask this for manifolds of polynomial growth, but to get an equivalent relation question, we need to assume also bounded geometry. Okay, so this was answered. This question was answered in 2020 by the same bunch of people that were in the previous slide, Monami and co-authors. They showed that if the growth function of a graph is polynomial of the form r to the k, then the asymptotic dimension is O of k log k. So some constant times k log k is bounded. I said equal, so it's less or equal to this. And now their proof uses an aerial result of Klaus, Gaumer, and Lee from 2007, which was conjectured bilineal. And the result is the following. If gamma is a graph of polynomial growth, then there is a function from gamma to r to the power n, where to r to the n, where n is omicron of k log k, such that, well, this function is Lipschitz, so the distance of fu fv is 10, is less than 10 times distance uv, but also it's coarsely one-to-one, say. So the distance from fu fv is greater or equal to one. Now, if we had a stronger second inequality, we would have a coarse embedding, right? But this is a much weaker result than coarse embedding. And now, if you just consider maps with this property, of course, they could arbitrarily increase dimension, for example. You take one dimension thing and make it 10 dimensional by such a map, right? But what Bonamy and co-authors observed is that it doesn't go the other way. You can get a lower bound from this, even though it increases, it cannot decrease dimension. So this was conjectured by lineal. And of course, it's interesting to ask whether, in fact, you can have a coarse embedding. And I don't know that. I mean, so a coarse embedding would give some bound immediately. But this is much weaker than coarse embedding, but still it suffices to give a bound. Okay, so now I would like to talk about how to get a sharp bound, right? So this is a bound, but we don't know any examples of graphs with growth, say, n to the k that have asymptotic dimension k plus 1, right, or 2k, which this allows. So first of all, the growth function of a graph is the supremum of the cardinality of a ball of radius r, where I allow v to vary over all vertices. So some people call this the uniform growth function, but this is the growth function Lie considered, and this is the natural growth function to consider here, right? You take the maximal possible volume of a ball, where the volume, again, is just the cardinality of the number of vertices in the ball. And now the theorem is, if the growth function is strictly smaller than r to the k plus 1, so if gamma to the r over r to the k plus 1 tends to 0, then the asymptotic dimension is bounded by k. So the difference with before is that we just get a sharp bound. So in particular, there is no graph with growth smaller than the Kelly graph of z to the k and bigger asymptotic dimension. Let me, are there any questions maybe so far? Is the statement clear? I think.
Yeah, excuse me. I just have a question. It's Indira. Do you know what's the asymptotic dimension of Heisenberg group? Do we know the sharp bound or?
I guess
it's a small Heisenberg group.
I guess it's three, but I might be wrong. I mean, my guess would be three. First of all, it is known. Okay, for nilpotent groups, it is known. Now I don't want to give a wrong formula because you have these exact sequences, and you have an exact sequence like that. You have an exact formula. So for every and I think it's three.
Okay, great.
So, I should say, of course, group theoretically, my talk is not interesting because groups of polynomial growth are nilpotent groups. And since we understand them, that was a good question, actually, I mean, to say that. And since we understand them algebraically and we have these exact sequences, we have a formula which gives us the exact asymptotic dimension in all cases for groups of polynomial growth, right? But for graphs of polynomial growth, that's something, that is not so obvious, right? We don't have this algebraic description. Any other questions? Okay, so let me try to say something about the proof. So first of all, I would like to define, to give some sort of finer definition. So I will say that the arc dimension is less or equal to n, right? If there is a cover so that my definition works for R balls, right? So it's the same as the definition for asymptotic dimension, except I fix them, or now I call it R, right? So I say, can I play this game that I played before, but for R balls, not for every size balls, right? So for example, let's take a grid with size 10. So I take the infinite grid on the plane, such that the edge side has length 10 rather than 1, right? Now I claim that if, for example, I take the one dimension of this, the one dimension of this is less or equal than 1. Of course, the asymptotic dimension, since it's a grid, well, the asymptotic dimension is 2. But if I take this 1 or even 2 dimension of this, the 2 dimension of the grid is less or equal than 1, right? And the proof is obvious. I think you just, this, since you look at this at such small scale, at the one scale, it's easy to find this decomposition, right? I just decompose it into two sets of different colors, if you like, this red and the green sets. And if I take every one ball, it can intersect at most two of the sets, right? One green and one red, or it could be entirely side a red or a green. Okay, so this is a somewhat finer definition, but it's clear that the asymptotic dimension of a graph is less or equal to n if the R dimension is less or equal to n for all R, right? Okay, so if I can play this game for every R for a given space, this in fact is exactly the same as the definition of asymptotic dimension, right? It's just a technical device. And we have a lemma, for example, just to get used to this. So let's say I have a connect graph and X a subset. So I want to understand the dimension of the subset. If there is some n such that the growth of the graph, so just for this specific n, right, just a fixed n, satisfies that the growth at n is less than 1 over 2 r times n, then the R dimension of X is 0. So, and now the reason is, so the proof is immediate. So it's just to get digest this notion, if you like. The reason is that if I take an R connected set, where by R connected, I just mean that, that distinct dots are a distance at most R, then R connected sets have diameter less or equal to N, right? Just by my growth assumption. I cannot have big blobs of these R-connected sets, or I would contradict my assumption. But now these blobs are going to give me, these R-connected blobs are going to give me my cover, and the diameter of the sets of the cover is bounded, which shows that the R dimension of X is zero, right? Because if I take an R ball, it intersects at most one of my blobs. Okay, so now, in general, I would like to apply some sort of induction. So I'm going to define what it means for a subset to be DR separating. So maybe you can look at the picture. A DR separating set, so it's this is my green set in this picture, is a set that breaks the space into R connected components. R components, maybe they're not connected, but which have diameter, let's consider R connected components, which have diameter at most D, right? So I just break up my space. So this is a DR separating set. Okay, so let me give you an example of a DR separating set, right? So let's take the plane and now take a thickened grid, right? So a thickened grid is a DR separating set. So I can take a thickened grid so that the whole white space in between has diameter at most 100 R, and the grid has thickness R, right? So this is an example of DR separating set. And now if I go back to my proof that the asymptotic dimension of R2 to the classical proof is less than 2, you might say, okay, this is a simple proof, but it's a bit bizarre because it uses these bricks, right? So when somebody asks you about the dimension of R2 or something, you tend to think of the grid, right? So, and I'll show you this is the right way to think about it. In fact, forget the bricks, we can prove it using the grid. The asymptotic dimension of R2 is 2. So this is my proof. So here is a proof. We take this thickened grid, right? And now since the R dimension of the grid is 1, the R dimension of the thickened grid is also 1. If I take an R ball, I can have a cover of my thickened grid that intersects at most 2 of my sets of the cover, right? It's exactly the same thing as we said before, that a grid has R dimension 1. Okay, but now if I think of this as the whole plane, so I have a cover of the green, red pieces and also the white pieces, right? The space in between, then you see that my R ball intersects at most 3 of these pieces, which proves that the R dimension of the plane is at most 2. But we can play this for every R, right? So this shows that the asymptotic dimension of the plane is 2, just using the standard grid. Okay, so in every mathematical talk, there should be one proof, and that was my proof that the asymptotic dimension of R2 is 2, a new proof of this. Okay, but now what is good about this proof? While one couldn't play with bricks when you have general graphs of polynomial growth, we can play with these DR separating sets. So this is the strategy, and I might not say much more about the proof. So the strategy works in general. If we fix an R and take a DR separating set with D much greater than R, then the growth of X at the scale N comparable to R is of the form Cn to the K minus 1. So this is the idea, right? As the grid, our grid had small R dimension because it had small growth at some scale as we did in dimension 0. So by induction, we have a bound on the growth of X, and this gives us a bound for the R dimension of X of this DR separating set, which gives us inductively a bound for the R dimension of gamma. So I will say, I will go through the technicalities a bit, but this is the main idea, exactly what we did with the grid in R2. We took the thickened grid, right, and we saw, okay, the thickened grid has a small R dimension for a fixed R, but then we could play this game at every level, at every scale R. So this gave us the R dimension of R2. And this is exactly the same argument that is going to work for graphs, for graphs of polynomial growth. So so now we need...
Hey, I'm sorry, Panos. Can you go back to the DR separating set definition?
Yes.
You want the complement to be a bunch of connected pieces of diameter less than D,
are connected pieces, yes, of diameter.
But you need to have enough of them so that, you know, some neighborhood of it covers the whole space or something like this. Well, otherwise, I could just take a hole.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, but then I wouldn't
We have to play. So this is a definition. So now we'll need minimal such sets, right?
I see. And okay. It's only if you have a good DR separating set that you can actually finish your proof. Okay, thanks.
Right. Sorry. Yeah. So I need to take. That's a good remark, right? So yeah, this is an empty definition. I could take the whole space, right? It does nothing. But now, the game you're going to play is you want to look at this set and you're going to take the smallest possible such set, right? Now the smallest possible such set for a fixed R, right? Okay, so the smallest possible such set is going to have smaller R dimension, so you have to work at each place, at each scale separately, and this will do, okay? So.
Thanks, I got it.
Okay, so we have, again, we want to look at minimal DR separating sets, and now this is where it gets a bit technical, because your minimal separating set might be minimal when you intersect it with a ball of radius n, but not minimal anymore when you intersect it with a bigger ball and a bigger ball and a bigger ball, right? So for each ball, you can say, okay, this is a minimal DR separating set, minimal in the sense it has the smallest number of vertices, but now when you change the size of the ball, maybe the sets change, and you might not have exact convergence, right? So that it works. So, but this is not a big obstacle, right? It just says that you have to define the minimal separating set carefully, and this is what this definition does, right? It says, okay, we define it so that it works for every ball, and so on, and then we take a limit. Okay, and then if you take this careful definition for this to work, these minimal DR separating sets do exist, right? And this is what we want to work with. And then the main technical lemma is if we have, again, a bound of the growth, so we have an R, so we fix this R that we want to play with, we want to bound the R dimension for this R, and now we assume that for some n0 that is much bigger than R, 4 to the m times R, we have this nice inequality for the growth. So since this coefficient 1 over 4 to the R to the k is quite small, you can think that n0 is much bigger. To get this n0 is much bigger than R. But then if we have a subset that satisfies this, then its R dimension is less than k minus 1. So if we have this small growth, the R dimension is less than k minus 1. Okay, so how do we prove this? We'll take a minimal separating set now, 2n0 R separating set of x, right? And the central inequality, the central thing to prove, so again, now I'm taking separating sets, not for the whole space, DR separating sets, not for the whole space, but for a subspace, because to carry the induction, I need this more general setting, right? To take these separating sets for subsets, but I can do that. And now I claim that when we do that, the growth drops farther. So this separating set, if my original had growth n to the k, has even smaller growth. So a similar, satisfies a similar formula by but it has a smaller growth. So then by induction, by the same lemma, right? So the case n equals zero of the lemma is proven already, right? It was my previous result for zero dimensional sets. So the n equals zero case is done. So now by induction, if I have this bound on the growth, I'm done, right? So the crucial thing is to prove this bound for the growth for the separating set, for the separating set Y, but the idea is very simple. So again, I have drawn Y as this thickened grid. If the growth of Y is bigger than the expected, then just look at surfaces around the point V, right? At spheres, at thickened spheres around V. Because of the polynomial growth, I have a control of how big are the spheres. So if the growth of Y is too big, I can just cut by this sphere, by this annulus, say a thickened sphere. So I shouldn't say spheres. When I say spheres, I mean our neighborhood of spheres, right? Because we want the set to be dear separating. So I take the Stickian sphere, I cut by it, I throw away what is inside the sphere, and I have a smaller separating set, dr separating set, which contradicts minimality, right? So d is here 2n0, right? Okay, so this is a proof, right? So this proves this inequality, and by induction now I have that the r dimension of x is bounded by k. Was it k? By k minus 1. Yeah, it doesn't matter. So again, by induction, we have this inequality, and since the R connected components have bounded diameter, right, of x minus y, I have that the R dimension of x is bounded by, well, by k minus 1, sorry. So I get the bound I wanted for x. And of course, this implies the theorem now, right? Because if the growth satisfies this, gamma to the r over r to the k plus 1 is equal to 0, then for every r, there is an m, such that for this big n 0, I have the inequality, the exact inequality I had in the lemma. So by the previous lemma, the r dimension of gamma is less or equal to k. Okay, so this ends the proof. The proof, the theorem clearly follows by the lemma, right? Okay, are there any questions? So this gives us a sharp bound. So maybe some remarks. Of course, we get the same theorem for manifolds of bounded geometry and polynomial growth. Now, if you don't assume bounded geometry, of course, it's false because you can just take a graph and thicken it and make a two-dimensional manifold of volume less than one, right? You can always do that. And then, or do I need an extra dimension? No, you can have a two-dimensional manifold of volume less than one and infinite asymptotic dimension. So, but I'm not sure, for example, if we assume non-negative Ricci curvature, if we can get rid of the bounded geometry assumption in this. So maybe some geometer in the audience knows the answers to this. Anyway, this is the end of the first half of the talk. So I will move on unless there are more questions. Okay, so this is about the systolic inequality, and this goes back to 30 years ago. So I was discussing with Thomas, and of course, the only thing we cared about at that time was understanding hyperbolic groups. And at some point, he told me that, you know, there is this filling paper of Gromov that is not well understood by the community. At the moment, I didn't make anything out of it, but I still remember this conversation. And then 30 years after, I came back to this, trying to understand this filling paper. So here is a definition. Let M be a non-simply connected, closed Riemannian manifold. The systole of M is the length of the shortest non-contracted loop in M. So in this example of torus, of this metric on the torus, I have drawn the systole. And now there is a result of Lerner from the 50s, which gives a bound for the systole of the torus. So the systole of the torus is bounded by this constant times the square root of the area. And this is optimal, and it's one of the very few cases where we have an optimal, an exact sharp bound for the systole. Now, some other remarks. So I gave you an upper bound for the systole, in the case of the torus at least. There is no lower bound in general, right? Because you can always pinch. I mean, we are looking for bounds where we are allowed to pick any Riemannian metric, right? So this, the bound of Lerner is valid for any Riemannian metric you put on the torus, and it is an upper bound. Well, we cannot hope for a lower bound because we can always pinch our curve, right, and make it as small as we like. And the second remark is we cannot hope to get an upper bound for all manifolds in terms of the volume. For example, if you take S2 times S1, the You can arrange so that the volume is equal to one and the systole goes to infinity, right? Just take a very smallest two and the very biggest one. So there is no upper bound for every manifold. So now the main theorem is Gromov's from 85. So for any n-dimensional closed aspherical Riemannian manifold, the systole is bound in terms of the volume by the formula. The systole is bound by a constant that depends on the dimension times the volume to the 1 over n. So this 1 over n shouldn't confuse us, because of course any such formula should be invariant by dilation of the metric, right? So if we multiply the metric by lambda, the systole is going to be multiplied by lambda and the volume by by lambda to the n. So we expect this. So the only significant term is this c to the n, and Gromov gave the bound c to the n, c of n is less than 6 times n plus 1 times n to the n times square root n plus 1 factorial. So just to repeat myself, another way to say it is the systole is bounded by the volume. So what this theorem says, let's fix a dimension. And now let's take any manifold of dimension n, just pick any aspherical manifold of dimension n of volume 1. So you are allowed, you pick any manifold, you don't restrict the topological type, and you are allowed to put any metric on this manifold, any Riemannian metric, so that the volume is 1. Okay? Now, if you do that, the theorem tells you, okay, the systole, no matter which manifold you picked or which metric, is bounded by a constant c of n, right? So this constant depends only on the dimension. Okay, so any questions? Well, I guess, I hope it's clear. And now Gromov's proof. So this is a very simple looking theorem, right? You would expect a very simple proof perhaps, but this is not quite the case. So we need, so the main new ingredient that Gromov used to prove this was the filling radius. Now I have drawn a picture. So the filling of a torus embedded in R3, right? So you see the torus as a chain, and now you take a homological filling of this, and you see in which neighborhood of the torus you can fill, right? So the filling radius is a smaller star, such that in this neighborhood you can fill. However, to work this out, of course, manifolds don't sit in Rn. So what Gromov did, he used the Kuratowski embedding from M to L infinity of M. So you embed M to the space of L infinity functions on M, and then you look at the filling in this infinite dimensional space, and this is how you define the filling radius. He proved the following two facts. The first is that the systole is bounded in terms of the filling radius. And the second, he used isoperimetric inequalities in this infinite dimensional space to show that the filling radius is bounded by the volume. So now the two together, of course, imply what we want, that the systole is bounded by the radius, by the filling radius, and the filling radius is bounded by the volume. So the systole is bounded by the volume, well, bounded by c to the n, times volume to the 1 over n. So the first part is a relatively simple argument, while the second part was quite technical, but was simplified relatively recently by Wenger. So there was another proof. Okay, however, it's still quite puzzling. In order to prove such a simple geometric statement that the systole is bounded by the volume, to use the embedding in L infinity of M, right? So, in the second part of my talk, I will try to give a different approach to this systolic theorem, to this systolic inequality. So we need another notion, Uryson width, which is again a notion of dimension. So X has Uryson Q with less than W if there is a Q-dimensional simplicial complex in the continuous map from your space X to the Q-dimensional complex Y, such that every fiber, so every pi inverse of Y, has diameter at most W in X. So I have drawn some pictures of say, two-dimensional spaces that in a way look one-dimensional. So they have small one width, right? So you see this torus on the left is close to a circle, and my strange sphere is close to a Y, to a tree, a Y-shaped tree. And now, Gromov also showed that the filling radius is bounded by the Uryson width. So we saw before that a bound on the filling radius bounds the systole, but now if we have a bound on the Uryson width, we can also get a bound on the systole. And so now Gromov made several conjectures related to this work, and Guth proved one of them. So let's denote by, so V of R is similar to the growth I defined earlier, right? It's the largest volume of any metric ball of radius R in a manifold M. And now what Guth proved is that there is an epsilon N such that if locally, there is a radius R such that every ball of radius R in M has volume at most epsilon n r to the n. So if it has very, if locally we have very small volume, then our manifold collapses to something lower dimensional. So the Uryson width, the n minus one Uryson width of our manifold is less than one. Okay, so again, what this says is if locally the volume is very small, then we collapse, there is this map, this continuous map to a lower dimensional complex. So I have drawn an example with a thin torus, right, which collapses to a circle. And now as a corollary, we get something that is similar in flavor to what we do in group theory. So if we have a closed spherical Riemannian manifold, then the volume growth of the universal cover is at least epsilon n r to the n for all r, right? So it's bigger. So this reminds us of manifolds of groups of polynomial growth, right? So these covers grow at least polynomially, but it's a different theorem. It doesn't involve actually group theory. And the corollary follows easily from the theory, modulo the fact that the filling radius of the universal cover of an spherical manifold is infinite, which is proven by a similar argument as before, using homology, but I'm not. So yeah, there is an argument for the first line for the right side of the for the left side of the proof, but the filling radius is less or equal than the Uryson width, which is infinite, right? So the volume cannot be epsilon n r to the n. So it follows. So the corollary follows by contrapositive from the theorem, right? Since we have infinite filling radius, the Uryson width is infinite, so the volume cannot be epsilon n r to the n for any r, right? So it has to be bigger. Okay. Now, the systolic inequality also follows from Guth's theorem by a cheap trick, right? We just choose r such that epsilon n, remember epsilon n is a constant, right? It's just a constant that Guth calculated, so that epsilon n r to the n is equal to the volume. Then the systole is smaller than the Uryson width, as we saw before, but the Uryson width is less than 6r by Guth's theorem, which is equal to cn volume the 1 over n. So this cn just comes from the epsilon n of the previous line. So it immediately follows. So we do get another proof of Gromov's theorem, except Guth's theorem somehow builds on techniques similar to the ones in Gromov. It doesn't quite use a Kuratovsky embedding, but again, we have an embedding in a mysterious high-dimensional space. Now, I would like to mention in passing the relationship with scalar curvature. There is a much stronger conjecture. So we showed that if we have the universal cover of an aspherical manifold, the volume grows at least epsilon r to the n. But the strongest conjecture is that if you have the universal cover of an aspherical Riemannian manifold, then the volume grows at least as in Euclidean space. There is nothing smaller than that, right? The volume has to grow at least as fast. And remember, this volume growth is we take the supremum, so we move the base point around and we take the supremum, right? So this is the notion of volume here. And this this is open, right? We don't know much about this, except one could remark that this would imply this the classical conjecture of Shen Yao that Mn does not admit a metric, that such spaces that do not admit metrics of strictly positive scalar curvature. Now, there has been a lot of recent progress on this conjecture of Shen Yao. So for n equal to 2, this conjecture, it follows from Gauss-Bonnet. For n equal to 3, it was shown by Gromov-Lawson in 83. For and now recently, there have been breakthroughs. So Chodosh-Lee showed it for n equal to 4 and Gromov for n equal to 5 in a couple of months ago. So, yeah, this is a very active field of research. And as I said, the sharp version would imply these results for every n, except this sharp version above is not known, not even for n equal to 2, right? So this seems to be a harder problem. Still, it's a beautiful question, I think. Let's go back now to trying to find a different proof of Gromov's theorem. So Karasev sent a year ago an email to Nabutovsky explaining that, in fact, we can prove this bound, that the systole is bounded by Uryson width without the filling radius. We don't need the Kuratovsky embedding. One can just use a direct homological argument and prove this, that the systole is bounded by the Uryson width. Still, of course, so that's good progress, but still we have to have a bound for the Uryson width. And now I would like to discuss this in a more general context. So I'd like to define the n-dimensional house of content of a subset of a metric space. So this is the infimum of the sum of ri to the n among all coverings of S by countably many balls, Bxi, Ri. So this is a similar definition as a Hausdorff measure, and it's easy to see that it's the n Hausdorff content is bounded by the Hausdorff measure if S is an n manifold. This hasn't been studied as much by analysts. One reason is that it's not quite a measure, but here it would play the role of volume, right? So if you have any metric space, so one good thing about this, in contrast to the Hausdorff measure, is that if you have any compact metric space, it's always finite for every n, right? The Hausdorff measure can easily become infinite, but if you have a compact space, the Hausdorff content is going to always be finite. And So again, I will use this as, or rather Guth introduced this as a substitute of volume in the very general setting of metric spaces. And he made the conjecture that his theorem, which was proven for manifolds, holds in general for proper metric spaces if we replace volume by Hausdorff content. So now this is a purely geometric metric space geometry statement. And now this conjecture was proven by Lisak, Lyukumovich, Nabutovsky, Rotman in 2019, but they use again Guth's argument, which is quite involved. It uses higher dimensional spaces and so on. And I'd like to sketch instead a more direct proof. So now again, the idea of the proof, or maybe I should say something more before going to the proof. Guth's conjecture, so it's in a way, so the house of content has some advantages. So for example, if you take a graph and take a thickening of it, say an epsilon thickening, right, but n-dimensional thickening, you see that this has very small n content growth locally. So the theorem would tell you that, or one content actually locally. So the theorem will tell you that it collapses to a one-dimensional space, that if you have an epsilon neighborhood of a graph, no matter in what dimension, in Rn, the theorem will still tell you that it's going to collapse something one-dimensional. However, if we use the classical notion of volume, Guth's theorem would only tell you that this epsilon thickening, the original theorem will tell you that this epsilon thickening collapses to something n minus one dimensional, which is not what you want, right? So this is another advantage of the content instead of measure, right? It gives you the right dimension of collapse. Okay, so let me try to give a sketch of the proof. So let's take a very specific case, and now let's say we have a plane and we thicken it, say in R3, so we have a thickened plane. So the volume, so it's a three-dimensional, my space now is three-dimensional, so volume or even content, for any notion of volume, but you can just think of the usual Riemannian volume. It doesn't really matter for this sketch. So the volume grows like R3 because it's a thickened plane, but epsilon times R3, right? Because it's very thin, right? So for some small epsilon, the volume is of the form epsilon times R to the 3. And now, assuming that we have this small local volume growth, we want to produce a map from M to something two-dimensional, right? To a two-dimensional simplicial complex so that the fibers are small. That means pre-images of the point have small diameter. We want to collapse this to something two-dimensional. Okay, so we'll do something similar to what we did before. We'll take a thickened grid. Maybe my picture could be misleading. So of course, since we have a thickened plane, this thickness in my grid goes, say, in the vertical direction. But the whole point, again, is we take a thickened grid that cuts the plane in pieces of diameter delta, of some small diameter. And now the crucial observation is that we can find such a grid which has small local volume growth, right? So the grid, there is such a grid, which you can think of it as being two-dimensional now, right? And it is actually in this sketch of proof. We had this thickened plane, but now we cut by a grid in pieces, and of course we only need two-dimensional grid to cut it, right? This thickened plane, we don't need three-dimensional grid. And I claim that we can find such grid so that the growth at scale R is some small epsilon times R squared. Okay, but now let's believe that we can do that. Then by the inductive hypothesis, we have a map with small fibers from G to a one-dimensional, from this grid to a one-dimensional simplicial complex. Okay, so we got this map and we want to extend now to the whole space. But now if U is one piece, then the boundary, the image of the boundary of the piece is contained in the subcomplex. And now of T, which was the one-dimensional complex I mapped, and TU is an absolute neighborhood retract since is a subcomplex. So its simplicial cone is an absolute retract, so we may extend the map from the boundary to the whole U. Now, all this last part is just classical topology, so that I had to learn. The point is, maybe you remember Tietz extension theorem, so if you are not familiar with this classical topology stuff, absolute retracts are spaces where Tietz extension theorem applies. Roughly, right? So you just need conditions that allow you to extend continuous maps. And it turns out that if you have a cone over an A and R, then this is an absolute retract and you can extend your map. So this is basically just by classical topology, this induct inductive step allows us to extend our map to the whole space, and we have a control on the fibers, because remember, I cut my space in small pieces, right? So my fibers cannot be bigger than the pieces that I cut, cannot have diameter bigger than the pieces. And this is, this is a proof. Okay. And now I see I went slower than I thought. I'll go through the technical details very, very quickly. I'll just go through the slides. So the n equals zero case is as before, right? If the content is bounded, then the Uryson, the zero Uryson width is bounded. And the reason is, again, we cannot have big blobs, right? Otherwise, I would contradict my bound on the content. So we cannot have big clusters. And now the other ingredient of the proof is the co-area inequality, which is which just says that if you want to have an estimate for the content, well, you just integrate the size of the sphere. So the size, the integrate, yeah. So if you have a ball, you can estimate the content of the ball by just integrating the content, the lower dimensional content of the spheres, right? So this is like Fubini. Anyway, so again, the proof just uses minimal separators. It turns out that we cannot have exactly minimal separators, but it suffices to have epsilon minimal separators. And the idea for showing that the separators have small volume growth is exactly the same as I stated before. If they did have big volume growth, using the co-area inequality, you could cut a sphere and contradict minimality of your grid, right? So this shows that your grid has small volume growth, which is the crucial step needed for the proof. And now an application. So Nabutovsky used this proof to improve the constant in Gromov systolic inequality. So now we know that the systole is bounded by not a strange constant, but just by n, right, times the volume. Okay, so sorry, I think I went a bit over time, but that's the end.
Thank you very much.